for the parents who are, you know, smoking the blunts on camera, changing behind the Zoom screen, I want a clown. That's a mess. Get it together. But I get it. You know, laptops are portable. These kids are on iPads. I might not realize that he just walked into my closet while he's on the Zoom call.
Welcome to Dear Culture, the podcast that gives you news you can trust for the culture. And I'm your co-host, Shana Pinnock, social media director for theGrio.
And I'm your co-host, Cortney Wills, entertainment director at theGrio. This week we're asking, Dear Culture, how are our kids really coping during all the craziness?
Yeah, but before we get into the show, Court, what's on your mind this week?
I mean, Breonna Taylor is still on my mind. I'm still reeling from that decision not to charge any of the police officers or anyone in her death. You know, as a Black woman, as a mother, as a human being, it's not surprising, but it's still hard to swallow that this is where we still are.
Mm-hmm. And you know what's so crazy is that it, because of one of those, you know, not surprising at all type of deals, it's been emotionally just ridiculous. And I think then also seeing kind of what has happened or transpired after this. So the day after we get the Breonna Taylor decision, you know, Daystar Peterson, also known as Tory Lanez, has decided that he, you know, has something to say about the whole situation about shooting Meg, and then proceeds to release an album, which, first off, you're over here, you know, you're lauding, what's her name? Kylie Jenner. You know, oh, let's talk about your crush for Kylie Jenner, but then you talk trash about, what is that little girl's name, Dream Doll, talk trash about Meg, you talk trash about, like, random basketball players, like, sir, first off, it's, again, one of those things of, I'm not surprised, because we have seen literally daily, and this is just another shining example of the disrespect and disregard of Black women. And for it to come from yet another Black man is just so frustrating and maddening. And honestly, all I can say is to my sisters, I love you, all of you, except for the ones, you know, Candace Owens, you're not a part of my sister group, but I love you all, and we are all we got, and, you know, I will forever support, love, protect Black women, and I wish everybody else did too.
Yeah. I mean, at a time like this, when parents are tasked with not only educating their kids, but kind of coaching them through all of this unrest, all of this uncertainty, trying not to give off the energy that we're all feeling. I mean, I've cried more this week. I've answered more phone calls from my strong friends, right? From the women who don't cry, from the women that I call when I'm crying. And they're crying, and they're devastated, and they're scared, and they're angry. And it's been really hard to, you know, put on a smile and carry on. And I think that parents right now are kind of pulling double duty, because we're all doing that with our jobs, we're all doing that with our peers, and, you know, we who are at home with our kids are having to do it for them, and it's a nonstop 24/7 job just to cope with what's going on, you know, in the news right now.
Definitely. Ugh, crazy.
So before we get into why the kids are not all right now, I want to talk about a kid that is doing pretty all right, and that is Marley Dias. If you don't know who Marley is, she's an amazingly talented, smart 15-year-old teenager who is also the star of a new series from Netflix called Bookmarks, Celebrating Black Voices. And what it is basically 12 5-minute episodes. You can watch them with your kids. You can sit your kids down to watch them while, you know, you go finish up dinner. But what it does is really explore all of the resources that there are for our kids, when, you know, especially when it comes to books, where they can see themselves represented. And so all of the books that they read are from Black authors, and there's a long list of really great celebrities who are going to read them to your kids, so you don't have to. Marley is also the founder of 1000 Black Girl Books campaign. That's a collection of books and conversations that she has with kids all around the world on the internet, so that they can feel supported and uplifted and seen, whether they're in preschool or high school. And a few of the celebrities that are participating in this incredible series are Tiffany Haddish, Caramel Brown, Lupita Nyong'o, Kendrick Sampson, just to name a few. And luckily, one of the perks of my job is that sometimes I get to sample some of the cool things that are going on in the world. So I wanted you guys to take a look. Behind me are a few of the books from that collection that Netflix was so kind to send me. And I can't tell you how excited my daughter was just to see, you know, a cover like this, which is, this one is by Grace Byers, I Am Enough. And it's like a beautifully illustrated book. There's a girl that looks like my daughter right on the cover. And, you know, representation goes such a long way when we're talking about kids. And my kids are 4 and 5. And I hate to admit it, but we've already had the conversations of, I don't want to be Black. Why do I have to be Black? None of the princesses are Black. Mm-hmm. Nobody looks like me. I want to be white, like Cinderella, like Rapunzel. And as a mother to, you know, a little Black girl, that is so devastating to hear, especially when I think I take for granted how many positive images there are of us kind of permeating my feed. What's in her feed? Mm-hmm. You know, what is on Nickelodeon and Disney, and what's on our bookshelves at school? It's usually not these. I actually have a son too, and he loves this book. It's called Crown, An Ode to the Fresh Cut, written by Derek Barnes and illustrated by Gordon C. James. And I mean, he got such an incredible kick out of this because it was the first time that he's seen something that's a weekly kind of tradition in our house spelled out in a book. And you know, when he's back in school, he can show his friends like what it's like for him, because it's certainly, however slight, a very different experience than the ones that, you know, his little white boyfriends have at school. And it's so gratifying to know that we can start from the beginning with these kinds of positive images. And I mean, they even have got it. Look, here's the answer to Avery's question. I wish I had this 4 years ago. Pretty Brown Face by Andrea and Brian Pinkney. This is how young they need to see themselves. This is how young they need to celebrate themselves. This is how young they need to normalize being Black in this world, instead of going to school for the first time and realizing that shit looks different here than it does at home. Mm-hmm. So I'm so proud of Netflix. I'm so proud of Marley, you know, for the work that they're continuing to do, whether it's for all of us or for the kids. But I think right now more than ever, we need content that we can consume as a family. We need to see Black joy highlighted and illuminated and celebrated. And you know, this is one small step that you can take to start that with your kids, whether they're in school or at home right now.
Where do we start when it comes to our children? You know, Court, as a very successful, phenomenal Black woman, you know, that has to work, and how have you been able to manage work and your children's virtual schooling?
You know, Shana, I wish we had 5 hours to talk about that. But, you know, manage, the first thing I've done is I've changed my definition of what manage means. Because the reality is, you know, that initial, you know, that enduring problem of any working parent has always been balance. And now we find ourselves in a pandemic, kids are home from school, and there is really no right way to do this. We don't have any, you know, reliable guidelines on what this should all look like. And we're all figuring it out day by day. And just when I think I have it figured out, another curveball comes, whether it's from the government, the news, or from my own kids. So I have learned to adapt, and I have learned to give myself every single ounce of grace that is humanly possible. Because one thing that we don't have time for when we're juggling all of these things is we don't have time to beat ourselves up. We don't have time to put ourselves down. We don't have time to, you know, cry in the closet because you only got one thing done at work. You know, I hope that other parents are as lucky as I am to have a very supportive team of coworkers who understands that I don't actually know what I'm doing all of the time. And, you know, they have extended me grace that I have been able to kind of mirror and give myself. Mm-hmm. The other thing that I've done is really just decided to stop bitching and do what I can when I can. And one thing that I was able to do is I had a garage that I don't use. Don't really know why, but my husband and I park the cars outside. So we had this garage, we had this need for a place to homeschool our kids where they could still feel like they were having a real school experience. They could feel like what they were doing, you know, in their classroom was real and important. And so we basically took, you know, 2 weeks and worked at night when they were sleeping, worked early in the morning, worked on the weekends. We spent about $700 to convert our garage into an actual classroom. My kids are in kindergarten and preschool, so unlike some older kids, they can't sit at a computer and Zoom with the teacher for 7 hours a day. That's just not a thing. So they really needed something interactive. And I realized that if I hopped on Pinterest, hopped on Instagram, got a little inspo, you know, pinched my coins for a little bit, I was able to pull this off in not a lot of time and for not a whole lot of money. So I'm going to show you guys just a couple of things that we were able to do. And maybe you can glean a little inspiration for whatever your setup is at home. This tree situation, I am not a painter. It's a decal. It was $11 on Amazon. It kind of serves as their reading corner. And it did a ton to brighten up the room and make it feel special. Again, we're in a garage. So I needed a way to make it not feel like a garage. So I got some fabric. It was $5.99 a yard. I think it was from Joann's. And I made curtains to cover my garage door. I bought some colorful paint. I bought some chalkboard paint that could turn any piece of wood into a chalkboard.
Of course.
And, you know, I did my thing. So I'm going to show you right now just a little bit of what that looks like. Bear with me here, guys. So this is a garage door behind here that now looks like a fun little wall.
Oh.
These cabinets, you know, I mean, it's spray paint.
All right.
It didn't take too long to do. That is actually my water heater that's covered with a piece of wood that we covered in blackboard paint, and now it's a blackboard. And that's a, you know, $9.99 projector screen piece of cloth that I got from Amazon, and I can project from my computer, I can project their Zoom teacher up there, I can project a movie when I need to take a phone call or do some work. So this is, it's just a garage, guys, with some stickers and some paint and, you know, a little imagination. And this is something that just really ended up being such a blessing to our family. I can stick them somewhere when I need to. They feel important and excited and like they're still going to school. And I feel like I did something to make this a little easier and a little brighter for my kids. Mm-hmm. So that's my classroom.
And that's so dope. You know, and I'm very, very proud of you as a childless woman. I don't have the time or patience, but kudos to you. And, you know, kind of just to jump in, just a real quick question for you. How can those of us who, you know, we are like the single friends or the single aunties or whatever else, how can we support parents during this time, if at all?
You know, I spoke earlier about talking on the phone and letting people cry. And I think there really is something so therapeutic about you guys doing what you just did, like ask, like acknowledge that we are going through something a little bit differently and understand that it never ever ends. So having a space for us to moan and complain about it, or pretending you're excited about a classroom. You might not give a shit, Shana. I don't know if you care about this classroom in a garage, but you know what? Like, recognize that's me trying to make the most of this and like celebrate those small little victories with us, I think. Normally I would say, offer to come over and watch the kids on a random afternoon that your work slowed up, but we're in COVID, so that's really hard. But you know, sometimes, my parents, for example, they'll read a book to my kid on Zoom And it might seem small, but that's 15 minutes that I can do something else. There are 24 hours in a day, 8 of them they're asleep. And the other 16, literally, is game on with our kids in the house all the time. So what might feel like a very small sacrifice for you, 15, 30 minutes of making silly faces or eating an ice cream sundae together over Zoom, is actually a lifeline for parents who are here all the time.
Wow, that's so crazy. Okay, cool. Education Secretary Betsy DeVos, or DeVos, was a supporter of virtual school this summer until Trump put pressure on school districts to open as normal. With this lack of leadership and consistency from the top, I want you to listen to some of the guidelines that a particular school representative laid down a few weeks ago. Let's check it out.
Number one, please, parents, wake your children up early enough to feed them and get them dressed for school. Also, make sure your child has the book, pencil, and paper when they sit in front of the computer. Don't lay down in the bed. Number two, parents, please make sure that you have on proper clothing when you're walking in front or behind the child's computer. Because we have seen them in their drawers, the bra, and everything else. All right, remember, all children are on the computer and can hear your conversation. So please try to use proper language. No cussing, because if I say there's no parents, they may not know what Spanish is. So no cussing, they know what that is. And number four, parents, when you are helping your children at the computer, please do not appear with big joints in your hands and cigarettes. The joint is big as a cigar. Oh, yeah, need a cigar.
So, Court, I have my own thoughts, but I want to hear yours. What do you think about, you know, those guidelines she just laid down?
I don't know what she's talking about. I mean, I don't think there's any parents drinking or smoking blunts during the day while they've got their kids doing math and social studies and they're on a conference call. I mean, okay, maybe I might know a few, but cut them some slack a little bit. You know, if the kid is on the Zoom at the time necessary and he's got a few more Cheerios to finish off, I really don't think it's a crime. I mean, granted, we're all trying to make the best of this and we're adjusting. So there's gonna have to be a little bit of that grace that I talked about extended to the kids and to the parents. If school starts at 8:30 and you know, a Breonna Taylor announcement comes out at 8:15, my kid's not gonna be dressed with her hair done, ready to go like she would have been if I didn't have a job, but I do, we're in a pandemic, shit happens. Now, for the parents who are, you know, smoking the blunts on camera, changing behind the Zoom screen, I want a clown, that's a mess, get it together. But I get it, you know, laptops are portable, these kids are on iPads. I might not realize that he just walked into my closet while he's on the Zoom call. I might be rushing out to change my shirt to get on my own Zoom call. So, you know, I mean, I think that some of that stuff was hilarious. Obviously, it's a bit of a mess, but we're going to get there. We're going to figure it out. Keep the blunts outside anyway, because, you know, parenting. but other than that, I thought that was that. You know, I needed that laugh and it made me feel like I wasn't doing that.
Yeah. For me, I'm of the mindset of leave these people alone. Okay, listen, I know how I feel when I'm like left to babysit my niece and my nephews for just a few hours or God forbid, overnight. And they're not little children, right? These are like the 14, 13 and 11. Them kids are crazy, all right? So I can only imagine having a tiny little human who, you know, you're supposed to first off try and keep together, blah, blah, blah. And then I'm also trying to work and then also trying to like make sure that this child is fed and all this other stuff, right? Like, listen, let people be in their house whatever comfortable way. I personally know. So if I saw, okay, if I keep my daughter in, you know, pajama pants or something like that, she might doze off during class. So maybe she does need to be in something, you know, that's actually like, hey, let's get ready for school so that she can feel more awake. But if that's not the case and my child is learning just fine and participating just fine in her pajamas, leave my baby in her Powerpuff Girl pajamas and mind your business.
Right. And, yeah. And the thing is, that parent probably 4 out of 5 days of that week their kid was dressed. But if they're not, just know some shit went down this morning and they're doing, you know, what they can do.
Are they here? Are they participating? If so, shut up and leave the baby alone and leave these parents alone. They are not okay. These parents are not okay. The kids might be fine. It's the parents.
Here's what that clip didn't highlight that I do want to talk about, because I'd be remiss if I didn't. And that's two things. One is that, you know, nowhere on that list was there, you know, any guidelines for people not having a Trump sign in the back of their Zoom, their kid's Zoom, a Confederate flag, perhaps. Two things I've seen in my own child's Zoom and been quite irritated about. When my kids see Donald Trump's face, they say, bad guy. That's the villain. Like, to them, he's this person who is a real life villain. So seeing it, you know, in their teacher's background or, you know, one of their classmates' backgrounds is really pretty offensive and sometimes traumatizing to kids, particularly kids of color. And the other thing that's happening is that Black kids, in, you know, much more discriminately, are being chastised, threatened with expulsion for things that teachers are observing in their homes, whether it's a bright neon green toy gun or a BB gun, I think, that fell over and a kid just leaned it back up against the wall and went back to class. They sent police to his home. So no one was in danger, because last I checked, no one's in the room here, you know, with us but my own kid. So he wasn't pointing a gun at the screen. He wasn't making a joke of it or threatening anybody. And they sent the cops to this child's house. So it's kind of mind-boggling that even when we're at home, even when our kids are at home with us, they're still discriminated against when it comes to schooling. And that's something that even a pandemic isn't changing.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, definitely. And, you know, they love to criminalize our children. They love to, you know, subject our children to adultification all of a sudden. The same things that wouldn't be, you know, it wouldn't even be blinked at if little Susie or Timmy did it. You know, little Shana and little Cortney can't get away with those things. You know what I mean? Daquan can't get away with those things.
Right.
I think it's so frustrating. And I, again, as a person who, I don't have any children, right? But it's always like, but what will happen when I do? You know what I mean? I think of, let's say COVID doesn't go away till like 2028. And I am here with a child and I'm, you know, have virtual schooling my child. Is my kid still going to have the same issues that we're dealing with now? You know what I mean? Yeah. Bless you. Bless all parents. I give every single one of you all props right now. It is not easy being a parent. I at least see that for sure. But I think just the amount of sacrifice that I've seen parents have made, and granted, it's your kid, you're going to do that. Well, I would hope that you would do that anyway, but to be able to, you know, figure out a way to get past this ridiculous hurdle that we're all dealing with, you know, not a lot of people are able to do that. I hope you know how blessed and how fortunate you are, Court. And you know how loved you are, because whatever we can do to help, man, this is a crazy time for everybody. But I think, I don't know, I hope everything from, we have new leadership who actually knows what they're talking about and what they're doing, so that maybe this doesn't have to be a new normal for these, you know, young people.
Right. Yeah. Right. And normalizing it for them, I think, has been the biggest struggle. And that's the thing that's, you know, happening with time. We wear masks when we go outside because there are germs out there, and you can't go to real school because, you know, we don't want you to get sick or make your teacher sick. And for now, you know, that's the story, and I'm sticking to it until I see some real measurable change when it comes to the way that we're spreading this COVID and the way that we're spreading this dangerous rhetoric that poisons our kids' minds far too long. Shana, another thing that is helping to keep me sane right now is just consuming all of the content that makes me smile, makes me laugh, you know, whether it's mindless or really important, you know, depending on the day. I'm letting myself sit there, chill. And one of the greatest gifts that Netflix has given us is this new special from Michelle Buteau. If you don't know her, she is the scene-stealing queen of comedy right now. And she has a new special on Netflix. It's her first hour-long comedy special. It's called Welcome to Butopia. And it is such a good time. I got to see it and I got to catch up with Michelle about how she's holding it down with two very young twins during the pandemic, and why right now was the right time to give us this gift of just giggles and laughs at the silliest, most mundane shit. And she's so good at that. She's such a joy to watch, and her style is so refreshing. So take a look at how that went. Really excited to talk to you today, particularly today after such a nightmare of a day yesterday that we had on the news of, you know, no justice for Breonna Taylor. Yeah. And so I found myself watching your special again. It was my third time and I just needed to laugh. And I wondered for you, you know, how important is it for us as Black women to like make the time and make the room in our brains and in our hearts right now to like have a giggle and still be silly when everything feels so heavy?
It is so insane. We are so underappreciated. It is, it's unbelievable that that wall got more justice than Breonna. And now that I'm a mom, I sometimes cannot fall asleep because I think, what would it be like if somebody just came charging through my bedroom door? But with that said, when you're talking about the special, sometimes, because I am sensitive, it feels like, wow, is this inappropriate to drop a special right now when we're going through the worst year, I think, ever in history? This is, I don't even know how to wrap my mind around the levels of insanity of what this year is. I can only hope that when things get worse, they only can get better. And so my husband, who is amazing, is a constant reminder, like what you just said, people need to laugh. They need to forget. They need to have a drink and take their bra off and sit on the couch or their futon or whatever and be like, hey girl, hey, with my disco ball titties. And I'm like, okay. Because, you know, it feels inappropriate, but I have my girlfriends who always remind me that joy is also an act of resistance. Yeah. So, you know, I'm here for it. You know, if you want to come and have fun and just, you know, not necessarily forget, but just, you know, forget for an hour the dumpster fire that is America, then I am here for you, honey. Yes. And if you don't get it, then that's your fault.
Absolutely. And I mean, how could you not get it? Your special is so funny. You are so much fun to watch. Your face just kind of exudes joy all the time. And that's so refreshing. And then as a mom, you know, I know your kids are little. How old are they?
They're 20 months, which I guess is a year and a half because I'm bad at math.
Right. Okay. So a year and a half. I've got two little ones.
Oh my God, how old?
They're 4 and 5.
Oh, right. Taxes yet? God,
so we know that like the moms are, you know, your Black friends are not all right, but your Black moms are really not all right. And, you know, like you said, as a mom, everything is framed by that as a mom. Breonna Taylor hits different as a mom. The pandemic hits different as a mom. You know, the call for self-care, should I be out there marching in the streets or should I be, you know, at home taking care of these babies?
Yes.
It hits different as a mom. And so I wondered for you, when it comes to comedy, right? Like, how much are you thinking about your kids, aside from including, you know, anecdotes about them in your act, but how much are you thinking about your kids when it comes to representing yourself now as a public figure?
Oh my God, it's everything. It's who I am. They're my soul, they are me, you know? And I am going to be I'm going to be their greatest support. And they will hopefully look at my example of, you don't need rich friends. You don't have to make a sex tape. You could stay in your own lane. You could be this size. You could speak the truth. You could be vulnerable. You could be funny. You could be all those things. You could be whatever you need to be in order to be successful and happy and to feel complete, you know? I'm realizing now more than ever, especially learning how to sort of parent within a quarantine, I just want to say this to everybody, even if they're not a parent, like, there is never going to feel like there's a right way, because everything right is wrong. You want to send your kids to school, you know, and you feel bad about it. You want to keep them home. You feel bad about it. You need to take a trip out, because that will help everybody's, you know, spirit. Like, all of it is scary, you know, like, you are doing okay. We are doing okay. As long as we follow the rules, keep distant, wash our hands, wear our masks, man. Yeah, I mean, it's never going to feel 100% right. And that is okay. Because they don't even know. It's like, dad's not home. What are we supposed to be doing? I mean, Trump, get off the stage. Put Fauci back. I like Fauci.
Right? Oh, me too. Oh my gosh. Lastly, I just want to tell you, you kind of ruined my whole life, my whole job. Pushing toward... I've been avoiding 90 Day Fiancé for years. And when I heard you talk about it, I started watching it, and I've barely done shit else.
It's the best. It is the best, because there's so many levels. It's people that really believe in true love, one night stands, people definitely dating out of their box because they really want to live here. And I'm just like, do y'all still want to live here? So it is... Where's the lost and found box? Is the lion there? Yeah, I'm so glad you're watching. If you take anything away from the special, make sure you got that basic cable TLC.
Girl, that was my takeaway. I am now in the cult of 90 Day Fiancé. So thank you for that. Well, thank you so much for taking the time today to talk to me. I loved your special. I can't wait to share it with all of our viewers and readers. And we're huge fans of yours. So keep doing what you're doing, girl.
Thank you. Mine called Pinnock Grio.
Ooh.
You're welcome.
I'll bring that up. Thank you.
7%, bitch.
I'd like to thank our guest, Michelle Buteau, who actually that Netflix special is premiering on September 29th. Be sure to catch it. And, you know, thank you so much, you guys, for joining us this week. And thank you, Court, for always bring us insightful conversations with people in the culture. So thank you. We want to remind our listeners to support your local Black businesses and donate to your local organizations and religious institutions. The business that we will highlight this week is Make Music Count. In a mission to eliminate math phobia in children, Morehouse College alum Marcus Blackwell founded Make Music Count, a mobile app that combines math and music to improve the arithmetic skills of the next generation while learning how to play music at the same time. The Grio has published a list of 50 plus Black businesses to support during the coronavirus pandemic. If you'd like your business to be featured, email us at info@thegrio.com. That's GRIO.com.
Thank you for listening to Dear Culture. If you liked what you heard, please give us a 5-star review and subscribe to the show wherever you listen to your podcasts and share it with everyone you know.
Please email all questions, suggestions, and compliments, we especially like those, to podcast@thegrio.com. The Dear Culture podcast is brought to you by The Grio and executive produced by Blue Talusma and co-produced by Sundas Hassan, Kyrie Williams, and Kevin Y. Brown.